Button and then we'll start. Okay, good. So again, thank you for coming to the first talk of the year. I want to tell you a little bit about some work that I've done with a longtime collaborator of mine, Horatio Nastasi, in which we extended some work that we did in 2016, which I'll talk through as we go along. But we extended the work that we did in 2016 on what has now become known as a web of dualities. These are essentially three-dimensional dualities that we've managed to extend to four dimensions. So this was work that, at least for us, was motivated from string theory. It was motivated back in 2012, 2013, when we were studying a set of three-dimensional Chern Simons matter theories called ABJM, which are supposed to be dual to type 2A string theory on ADS4 cross CP3. So this was a very roundabout way of getting to the point that I'm getting to today, which is that there's an enormous amount of work done on low-dimensional quantum field theory as opposed to anything string theoretic. So what I'm about to say today has really nothing to do with string theory, at least not from my perspective. It has more to do with quantum field theory, and in particular the quantum field theory that you would encounter, for example, in low-dimensional condensed matter type applications. Once we got into this area, we started thinking more and more about things like topological insulators and topological superconductors, et cetera. So this work is largely based on a paper that we wrote last month. It took us a year to write this paper, but we put it on the archive last month. And the archive number is 2103-12667. And we tried to be as clear and self-contained as we could. So I urge you to take a look at that paper if you're interested in these kind of ideas. So I labeled this talk, the title of the talk, A Four-Dimensional Duality Web Part One. And that's because I don't think I'm going to get past the first part of the paper today, because I want to really try and be as pedagogical as possible. So I'm going to try and introduce these ideas in as clear and pedagogical way as I think I can. And this is largely for the students in the audience. And so I don't see anyone that's explicitly worked in this area before. So I won't draw the usual caveat of experts in the audience humor me. But so I'm going to try and be as pedagogical as possible. And today I'm largely going to focus on the three-dimensional duality web. And I'll explain why it's called a web, why we're talking about three dimensions, and what's peculiar about three dimensions, and in particular, what lessons we learn in three dimensions that we can port to four dimensions. and I'm going to stop frequently and ask if there are any questions. And again, I really do urge you to ask me questions if you have any. So are there any questions to start off with? Okay, so if there aren't, I want to start off by a very, for me anyway, kind of obvious observation. And that is the statement that dualities are everywhere. They really are ubiquitous. We encounter them in many different settings, some of which you're already familiar with, and some of which are possibly new to you. So to convince you of this fact, let me give you some examples. And again, some of them you probably know already. In fact, the first one I want to talk about, you definitely know, or you definitely should know. And that's the idea of so by the way, this is going to be the Zoom version of a Blackboard talk. So I'm going to be writing as we're going, if that's okay with everybody. This is the idea that we know as electric magnetic duality. An electric magnetic duality is a pretty straightforward statement. It's something that you would have encountered in first year already. And it's a statement that the vacuum Maxwell field equations are invariant under an exchange of the electric and magnetic fields. So this is the statement that the vacuum Maxwell equations are that the divergence of the electric field is zero, the divergence of the magnetic field is zero, the curl of the electric field is minus the rate of change of the magnetic field. These all being three vectors in four-dimensional space-time. And these equations are invariant if I exchange the electric field and the magnetic field. So they're invariant under the pair electric field, magnetic field mapped to magnetic field minus electric field. So this is a fairly innocuous observation, right? You wouldn't think that it's a particularly deep observation, but in fact it is, because this observation leads directly to the idea of S-dualities that we'd encounter in string theory. And in fact, it's at the core of Kapustin and Witten's physical interpretation of the geometric Langlands conjecture. So it's right up at the cutting edge of mathematics as well. So this leads to things like S-duality and the geometric Langlands conjecture. And so even though it seems like it's an innocuous observation, you just exchange electric field and magnetic field with a minus sign, and the Maxwell equations stay invariant, it's actually a really, really deep observation.
Jeff, just a comment.
Sure.
There's an identical symmetry in the general relativity equations when you interchange the electric and magnetic part of the Weyl tensor.
Yep, absolutely. So, in fact, that's related to another deep statement about the relationship between gravity and gauge theories, and in particular, gauge theories like Yang-Mills theory. The second type of duality that some of you may be familiar with is what we would call the gauge gravity duality. This is the idea that a gauge theory, like Yang-Mills theory, is dual in the sense that the physics captured is exactly the same as a theory of gravity, and particularly a theory of quantum gravity in one dimension higher. Okay. I don't want to say anything about the gauge gravity duality today. I want to focus rather on more prosaic type of dualities that we'd encounter in field theory. But sticking with the slightly string theoretic theme here, another type of duality which actually encounters in field theory as well is what we would call T-duality. And T-duality is a map between two different sigma models. These are two-dimensional field theories. So T-duality maps a sigma model, which is a collection of data from this point of view. I'll tell you what this is just now, to another set of data, x tilde, g tilde, and b tilde. So what do I mean by these things? X here is some two-dimensional manifold. X here is some smooth manifold. on which there is a metric defined, which I'll call G. And B here is some two form that's defined on this space, and in fact on the space of two forms over X. And X tilde, G tilde, and B tilde are a different set of manifold, metric, and field that is related to the first by this TDRD map. Okay, so for example, a free boson on a circle of radius R is T dual to a free boson on a circle of radius 1 over R. And you see, I can talk about bosons, I can talk about free bosons and things like that without mentioning anything about string theory. In fact, TDRD is an operation carried out at the level of the whirl sheet of the string, or in another way of saying it, at the level of a two-dimensional field theory. The one that's going to be most important from our perspective in this talk is what we would call bosonization. And bosonization is a map which takes a theory of, let's say, relativistic Dirac fermions to a bosonic field that captures the same physics. Now, I must be careful here and distinguish this between supersymmetry, which exchanges fermions and bosons. This is not the same thing as supersymmetry. This is, in fact, something not to do with supersymmetry at all. It has to do with the way, it has to do with collective effects in the fermionic field. So this is a map between fermions and bosons. And the most famous example of this is the so-called massive Thuring model, with the Sein-Gordon field theory. And there's some remarkably rich physics that's contained in even this one example. Right. Bosonization is a whole class of examples, but even just thinking about the massive Thuring model, Sein-Gordon duality, there's an enormous amount of really rich physics sitting in there. So in particular, the Sein-Gordon model is a nonlinear theory. So is the Thuring model. It's a four fermi interacting theory, so there's quartic interaction with the fermions, and the solitons in the Sein-Gordon model, which arise because of its nonlinearities, get mapped to fermions in the Thuring model. Quantum excitations of the fermions get mapped to zero modes of the Sein-Gordon solitons, etc. So there's an enormous amount of really rich information sitting in this idea of bosonization, and it's going to be the seed of most of what I'm going to be talking about in today's talk. So there are actually a couple of things we should stop and think about here. The first thing is, I've given you a wide class of things that we're calling dualities. some of them map theories in different dimensions to other theories in different dimensions. Some of them are classical dualities. Some of them are quantum dualities. But all of these examples that I've given you actually have some commonality. And some of the common ingredients in here are the following. So the first thing is that, actually, let's go to the next page. The first thing here is that the duality maps a theory at strong coupling to a theory at weak coupling. So these are what are called strong-weak dualities. So they map strongly coupled and respectively weakly coupled theories to So that's a really interesting observation in the following sense. Most of the theories that we're interested in, well, okay. So if I'm interested in quantum field theory, there's only a finite set of things that I can really calculate in a theory, in a quantum theory. One of the main observables that I'm interested in computing in the quantum theory are correlation functions. Now, the problem with correlation functions is that you can very, very rarely compute them exactly. And so typically what we tend to do is we do what's called perturbation theory. And perturbation theory is like doing a Taylor expansion. And if you want to do a Taylor expansion to go from the zeroth order term to the linear term to the quadratic term, et cetera, you need a small parameter to make expansions over. So typically the small parameter employed by physicists in these theories are the couplings, the strength at which the ingredients in the theory talk to each other. Now, the problem is that when you're at regimes in which those couplings become strong, then you don't have your small number to make a perturbation expansion over. And so then you're a little bit stuck. So what dualities afford you, one of the things that dualities afford you is the ability to take a theory that is strongly coupled and consequently hard to access and map it to another theory that supposedly contains exactly the same physics, but that is weakly coupled and that you can probe perturbatively. So this is an important aspect of why we study dualities so much. The second lesson to be learned out of this is that all of the examples that I gave you, except the gauge gravity duality, can be formulated as a path integral. And I'll tell you what I mean by that now. In the following sense. So what I do is I start with something I'll call a master path integral. Which we'll call, let's say, Z master. And this Z master will be a path integral. And now I'm just using capital phi here and capital lambda for a whole collection of fields. I don't really care what they are at the moment. It will depend on what the theory is that we're working with, exactly what phi and lambda are. So I start off with this master path integral, and then I can do the following. If I integrate out the field lambda, so if I integrate out lambda, I'll produce a theory that only tells me about phi. This is the original theory that I start off with, all right? Some action in some set of variables, phi. On the other hand, I could, instead of integrating out lambda, I could integrate out phi. There are lots of caveats in this statement, but for the most part, this cartoon is true. If I integrate out phi, I'll get another theory, and this will be a theory for lambda. And this is what we will call the dual theory. Of course, this is a very hindsight perspective, right? So normally I wouldn't start with the master path integral. I'd start off from some theory with some action S of phi, the original theory. Then what I'll do is I will try to get from S of phi to this S master of lambda and phi, and I'll tell you what lambda is just now. And once I have the master path integral, if I integrate out lambda, then I get back to my original theory, but then I have the option of integrating out phi, and if I integrate out phi, I get the dual theory. So this is a very cartoon formulation of what these field theoretic dualities are all about, okay? The idea that bosonization, that combinations of fermions behave collectively like a boson, can be formulated and thought of as this as a duality, actually came from the seminal work of Burgess and Quevedo in the early 2000s. And this is largely what I'm going to be focusing on, Burgess and Quevedo's formulation of bosonization as a duality is going to be the core of what we're going to be talking about today. So let me stop and ask if there are any questions.
Sir, I do have a question.
Yes,
Nitin. So basically, like, let's say we have a duality between a strongly coupled theory and a weakly coupled one. So yeah. What we, let's say we have three results in these kind of theory, okay? How do we know that the fourth result that we get in a strongly coupled, in a weakly coupled theory will be valid in the strong coupled reason? Like, I mean, how do we extend that? Is there any way to verify that the results that we can't calculate in strongly coupled theory, which we are getting from the weakly coupled theory, will be valid?
Right, okay. So in general, no. In general, we try to find regimes in which the two theories overlap as much as possible, right? So strongly coupled but not very strongly coupled, and weakly coupled but not very weakly coupled, so you can actually compare the two. This is a very rare case when you can actually do this, okay? There are very few examples in which it's possible to do this. However, much of what we understand about dualities, we can actually test them, they seem to agree. And so we build up a dictionary, more or less, of circumstantial evidence, to be fair. It has yet to fail. Does that answer your question, sort of?
Yeah.
Okay. So, you know, in something like the gauge gravity duality, this is particularly hard to do. But in simpler field theories, which is, you know, one of the reasons why I'm interested in these things, is because they don't have the nuances of for the most part, they don't have the nuances of gravity to worry about. They don't have issues of curved space to worry about, et cetera. So you can hone your methods. You can understand, you know, just how valid is your dictionary in very controlled circumstances. And once you build this dictionary and you've fortified the dictionary and you understand, you know, where it breaks down, et cetera, then you can take it and ask questions of more complicated theories like the gauge gravity duality. Okay?
Yeah.
All right. Any other questions? Okay. So now let me take a step back from you know, this specific formulation of dualities and talk about and just think about field theory in general. And in particular, I want to think about field theory in 2+1 dimensions. And the fact that we're on a plane is rather important here. Because one of the many lessons that we've learned over the past few years is that Chern-Simons theory is an incredibly beautiful theory. But it's an incredibly beautiful topological theory. In other words, pure Chern-Simons theory doesn't have any dynamical degrees of freedom. So it's a topological theory. And you would think that with all the beautiful topology that resides in Chern-Simons theory, why break that? Well, one reason to break that by, for example, adding matter, coupling the theory to matter, is that we've learned over the last couple of years that adding matter to Chern-Simons theory, to pure Chern-Simons theories, is still a rather rich theory. Much of this work has been done by Shiraz Minwala and his collaborators. And I'm going to draw a little bit on the lessons that we've learned from that work. But let me just start by making the statement that Chern-Simons theory is a rich and beautiful theory, even when coupled to matter. Okay. So one of the things that we've learned about these Chern-Simons meta theories can be summed up in a beautiful set of statements that we'll call Harony's dualities or Harony's conjecture that were written down by Ofer Harony. And they can be summarized as follows. So broadly speaking, and again, this is a very cartoon formulation, and I'll expand a little bit on what these various symbols mean. But for the most part, I just want you to appreciate the connections rather than the details of the dualities. This says that if I have some number of fermions, say NF of fermions, so NF being the flavor number. So if I have NF fermions, and I couple them to a UK level N plus NF over 2 minus N plus NF over 2, gauge field, then this theory is dual to a theory of NF scalars, bosons, coupled to an SUN level K gauge field. NF fermions coupled to an SUK minus N plus NF over 2 gauge field is similarly dual to NF scalars coupled to a UN level K comma K gauge field, and NF fermions coupled to a UK minus N plus NF over 2 minus N minus K plus NF over 2 gauge field is dual to NF scalars coupled to a UN level K plus N gauge field. So I should explain some of my terminology here. Firstly, this plus here is the statement that if I have these fermions, they're coupled to a non-abelian gauge field. So this means coupled to. These gauge fields are all typically Chern-Simons gauge fields. And the groups here, SUK, UK, et cetera, refer to the gauge group of the photons. And then there's some technicalities with what I mean by something like U n level k comma k, where, for example, let's say U, the group U m k comma l is S U m cross, S U m level k cross U one level m times l modded out by the group, the finite group Zm. Okay, so that's just some technicalities for anybody that cares. I'm really interested in a very special case of this, of these Aharonis dualities. And that is the case where K, N, and NF, the rank of the gauge groups, the level number K, and the number of fermions are all one. So everything's abelian in this story. Okay, so the reason why this is such an interesting case to consider, I mean, you would think if you understand everything about the non-abelian case and you can write down these dualities, what's interesting to learn about the abelian case? Well, it turns out that the case NF equals N equals K equals one is a little bit more interesting to think about, because here the statement, this Aharonis dualities translates into the following statement. It translates into the statement that a scalar a Wilson-Fisher scalar. So this is what you would normally call massless 5-4 theory. So I have a scalar field, a complex scalar field, and it typically has a mass term, which would go like mod phi squared, and it'll have a quartic interaction, which would go like mod phi to the full. And what I do is I dial the mass down to zero while scaling the coefficient in front of the phi to the four term, so that I hit a fish point, I hit what's called a Wilson-Fisher fixed point in the renormalization group flow of the theory. And this is what's called a Wilson-Fisher fixed point. I will call this a scalar that has that action. We will call a Wilson-Fisher scalar. Well, the Aharoni duality tells me that this Wilson-Fisher scalar is dual to a fermion, a single Dirac fermion, coupled to a U1 Chern-Simons gauge field. It also tells me, so that's point one. Point two is that it tells me that a free fermion is dual to a Wilson-Fisher scalar plus or coupled to a U1 Chern-Simons field. So what's remarkable about this is that condensed matter theorists knew about this a long time ago. In fact, the idea, both condensed matter theorists and high energy theorists knew about this a long time ago, and it arises in the study of anionic physics. So this is the physics of particles that are specific to 2+1 dimensions that don't have fixed boson statistics or fermion statistics. They can have a mixture of the two. And they're rather important in the context of, let's say, topological quantum computing. But I don't really want to say too much about that right now. I do want to point out one very specific aspect of this that was recognized by condensed matter theorists back in 2015. So over in the condensed matter community, some work by Dam Sun and later elaborated on by Ashwin Vishwanath and Max Metlitsky recognized that the 2+1 dimensional boundary of a 3+1 dimensional type of quantum matter called a topological insulator, which is a completely new type of quantum matter that we've only just started to get a grip on in the last 10 years, I'd say, that has the following interesting property. In a topological insulator, let's say I have this 3+1 dimensional object, the bulk of the insulator is insulating, right? So there's no free movement of electrons in the bulk. But the surface of this object is perfectly conducting. So these are really new materials that had not been noticed until people started focusing on these low dimensional quantum field theories. So obviously, you know, and they're quite intimately related to things like the integer quantum Hall effect and things like that. In fact, Dam Sun was trying to understand the composite fermion description of the integer quantum Hall effect, of the fractional quantum Hall effect, when he conjectured the following duality, which was then elaborated on by Vishwanath and Metlitsky. So Sun realized that realized the following, that the boundary, the 2+1 dimensional boundary of a 3+1 dimensional topological insulator, which I'm just going to denote TI, a topological insulator, can be described in two ways. Either it could be described as a gapless Dirac fermion, that is to say, if I take this Dirac fermion and I quantize it, its energy spectrum doesn't have a gap. Coupled to an external gauge field, like a magnetic field, or an equivalent description could be as a Dirac fermion what condensed matter physicists would call a composite Dirac fermion, coupled to a dynamical gauge field, let's call this guy A, itself coupled to the original gauge field, let's call this gauge field capital A. And the dynamical gauge field A is coupled to A. In other words, the statement here is that I'll have some Lagrangian for a Dirac fermion, I psi bar D slash A, where the D slash is the usual Feynman notation of a contraction with a gamma matrix, and capital D is a gauge covariant derivative with respect to the gauge field capital A. Right. And this thing is dual, this theory is dual to another theory where the Lagrangian is given by I chi bar, again, D slash, now gauge covariant derivative with respect to little a, the dynamical gauge field, which is actually an emergent gauge field, coupled to, plus a term that goes like 1 over 4 pi, capital A dA, where I'm abusing some differential geometric notation here, and what I really mean is A wedge dA, okay? So this was interesting because this was recognized as a fermionic version of what condensed matter theorists have known for a while now, and they were calling particle vortex duality. I'll tell you about that just now, but this is what became known as fermionic particle vortex duality. And so if there's a fermionic particle vortex duality, the question then would be, what is bosonic particle vortex duality, or just particle vortex duality? So there, you have the statement that a complex scalar, whose kinetic term is just d phi squared minus mod phi to the 4. So this is the Wilson-Fisher scalar. Remember what I said, you have Wilson-Fisher scalar is a scalar that's been tuned to this Wilson-Fisher fixed point, and it's basically just massless phi 4 theory. And this would be dual to a gauged Wilson-Fisher scalar, I'm going to call d little phi squared minus mod phi to the 4 plus 1 over 2 pi b dB, where this capital B is an external gauge field and little b is an emergent gauge field. Gauge covariant derivative is capital D, etc. So these are details that I'll expand on a little bit later. But essentially what it is what some of you may know as the Abelian-Higgs model. So the statement here is that the so-called O2 Wilson-Fisher theory, which is this guy on the left, it's O2 Wilson-Fisher, is dual to Abelian-Higgs or scalar QED, scalar quantum electrodynamics 3, okay? So these are old, well-known theories with old, well-known dualities, and in particular, particle vortex duality goes back a long way, and a very nice treatment of it for anybody who wants some more details is in Tony Z's quantum field theory in a nutshell. And in fact, the first time we'd learned this was from that book as well. Okay, any questions? All right, so, yeah.
an external field on the O2 Wilson Fischer side.
Okay. Oh, yeah, sorry, you're right.
Cool.
Yeah, correct. Thank you. Thanks. very good. So what I've actually described to you here are three different dualities. There's this O2 Wilson Fischer story that's dual to scalar quantum electrodynamics. And if you look at the this, on both sides of this duality are bosons, scalars, coupled to some gauge fields, which are also bosons. On the other hand, this fermionic particle vortex duality takes a fermion to another fermion. So now I have two types of dualities, fermion, fermion, boson, boson. And then I started off by telling you about bosonization, which maps fermions to bosons. It basically says under the right circumstances, a collective excitation of fermions behaves like a boson. Okay. You can think of Cooper pairs or something like that. But essentially, I have three dualities. One is a fermion-boson duality, the other one's a boson-boson duality, and the other one's a fermion-fermion duality. And together, these constitute what's called a three-dimensional duality web. so this is a really interesting story, and we approach it in a completely different way. And there was a large flurry of activity. But in 2016, three groups of people, there was Cyberg, Senthil, Wang, and Witten, which was a Harvard-Princeton collaboration. There was Andreas Karch and David Tong, which was a University of Washington, University of Cambridge collaboration, and myself and Horatio Nastasi, that realized that these three different dualities could be tied together to constitute a three-dimensional duality web, if you want, where each of these dualities could be derived from the others, starting from the others. You'd have some seed duality. Typically, this was taken to be bosonization. And the seed duality could be used to derive all the other dualities. So this is a beautiful set of relations that actually drove a number of new results since then. So let me just tell you a little bit about these new results before we go into some of the details. Okay, I'm not sure how much details I'm going to be able to go into, but we'll have this as a multi-part talk. Okay, so this led to a three-dimensional duality web. In the summer of 2016. And the works that I would refer you to is Cyberg et al. That's Cyberg, Senthil, Wang, and Witten. And then independently, Karch and Tong. And independently, myself and Nastasi. And these were released back to back on the archive. You can find them there. And this in itself led to a remarkable slew of work in the area. And partly this was due to the fact that this was a collaboration between condensed matter and high energy. So Karch and Tong are both high energy physicists, myself and Horatio are high energy Seiberg and Witten are high energy, but Senthilan and Wang are proper condensed matter theorists at Harvard. And so it brought back these communities of high energy physics, high energy particle physics, and condensed matter in a beautiful way that hadn't been seen since, you know, back in the 1970s, I guess. And like I said, it resulted in a bunch of work that followed this idea, and that it's work that's still going on and still going very strong. But I want to pick a couple just to illustrate some of the remarkable consequences. The first is work by Shamit Kachru and his collaborators in largely Stanford that demonstrated that the 3D web is a result, or can be derived, from a supersymmetric version that goes by the name of three-dimensional mirror symmetry. And mirror symmetry, 3D mirror symmetry, is the statement that a free chiral superfield with n equals 2 supersymmetric, a free chiral superfield is dual to n equals 2 supersymmetric version of QED 3 with a single charged superfield. So this is the statement that a free chiral superfield is dual to n equals 2 supersymmetric QED 3. Okay, so this was a really interesting result, because it kind of derived these three different sets of dualities as a single, put these three different dualities in a single unified picture of 3D mirror symmetry, which is a more controlled theory to work with. And the control comes from the fact that you have to respect the supersymmetry when you do this. And they found how to break the supersymmetry and flow to the infrared, so that in the low energy limit, you arrive at precisely this three-dimensional duality web. The second interesting point came from work of Seiberg et al., which took these abelian dualities and generalized them to non-abelian dualities, which then led, you know, kind of leads you down this rabbit hole that leads into these new states of matter called fractons, which I don't know too much about, so I'm not going to say much about it. But they're quite an exciting new phase of matter that a lot of people are interested in, and they kind of follow directly from these ideas. So Seiberg et al. Then generalized these ideas to non-abelian, non-supersymmetric. So this was work since 2016 that basically took the abelian theories and generalized them to non-abelian dualities. And then finally, I want to mention some work by, there's actually a couple more pieces of work. So Karch, Tong, and their students and collaborators extended these from relativistic dualities in 2+1 dimensions to non-relativistic dualities. And of course, non-relativistic dualities are more, they're kind of more relevant for condensed matter physics. More importantly for this work, the 3D web was extended, I don't know if you'd call it extended, but by Koch and Tong and David Tong's student, Turner, Carl Turner. So Koch, Tong, and Turner took the 3D web and showed how you can reduce the 3D web to 2D. Now, this was interesting because the first time that, you know, we were interested in the idea of bosonization was really in two dimensions, so in 1+1 dimensions. And it turns out that there are already an enormous number of dualities that were known, well known, not only in the context of field theory, but in the context of statistical mechanics, in the context of the Ising model, for example, where the Ising model in two dimensions exhibits precisely this kind of boson-boson duality called Kramers-Wanier duality. There's something called a Jordan-Wigner transformation that maps a bosonic Ising model to a Majorana Fermi model. And there's an immense rich physics already known there. But nobody had actually connected the dots. So along come Koch, Tong, and Turner in 2018 and connect the dots and show precisely how the three-dimensional duality web reduces to a two-dimensional web that in fact connects all of these puzzle pieces that we've known existed previously in a unified picture that kind of descended from the three-dimensional picture. Okay, so now we have a two-dimensional duality web, which it turns out was known in many ways before, a three-dimensional duality web in which the idea of Chern-Simons gauge fields and Chern-Simons theory coupled to matter, typically this is matter in the adjoint representation, encompasses this beautiful web of dualities that's highly relevant in the context of condensed matter physics. So very real life things. And it led us to ask the question, is there a similar web of dualities in four dimensions, four space-time dimensions? And if there is, why hadn't anybody written it down before? And in fact, we had started asking this question around about 2019, well, early 2020, I guess. And it took us about a year to properly formulate the problem. So then the question would be, well, you know, we start off with this three-dimensional dualities. And in fact, if you go looking in the Cyborg paper, you'll see hints that this is related to some four-dimensional duality. We know how to go from three dimensions to two dimensions in a way that encompasses all the known two-dimensional dualities in a beautiful way. And so why isn't it obvious how to extend this to four dimensions? So the question that we first needed to answer is, why is the extension not obvious? The first reason for this actually comes from the idea of using bosonization as a seed for these dualities. Remember, I said that bosonization is taken to be a seed in the sense that I can derive from the Bose-Fermi map, I can derive the Fermi-Fermi map and the Bose-Bose map. So why can't I do this in four dimensions? The reason why I can't do this in four dimensions is actually quite interesting. It turns out that in, let's say, capital D equal to D plus one dimensions, in general, bosonization maps a massive Dirac's fermion to a d minus one form field, which we'll call, let's say, B. Okay, coupled to some scalar. Sorry. So bosonization maps a massive Dirac fermion to a D minus one form coupled to a scalar, and the scalar has some derivative type interactions. Okay. For example, the massive Thuring model Sine-Gordon duality. The second point to note is that the bosonized theory is gauge invariant. So it's gauge invariant under if I send B, this D minus one form, to B plus the exterior derivative of some D minus two form. So this guy is a D minus two form. Okay, so that's great because I want my quantum theory to be gauge invariant. However, it turns out that in D greater than capital D greater than or equal to four, the bosonized theory is in fact non-local. As an example, in four dimensions, and in the large mass limit, the following happens. I go from a massive Dirac fermion, psi, to a theory that looks like this. This is some d-dimensional coupling constant. KD, but my interaction term or my scalar phi looks like one over the D'Alembertian operator. Well, it's actually the Green's function. If D'Alembertian is the Green's function is the inverse of the D'Alembertian, so one over box is really the Green's function for this theory, plus phi wedge A. Phi being a scalar here. So this one over box type interaction is a highly non-local interaction, which makes the theory less interesting than if I have local interactions. However, there are still reasons to be optimistic that the four-dimensional case. So the higher you go in dimension, the more non-local bosonization gets. You can go to D equals five, six, et cetera, but you're just getting worsely behaved theories. Now, there's still reasons to be optimistic, though. One rather compelling reason to be optimistic actually comes from the Seiberg paper, where Seiberg et al. Show that each of the dualities in the three-dimensional web can be embedded into three plus one dimensions. So this is to say that the theories that live in this three-dimensional duality web actually live on the boundary of some four-dimensional object. That four-dimensional object would be something like a topological insulator, and the three-dimensional quantum field theories live on the boundary of the three plus one-dimensional topological insulator. So these are not, so then you could kind of interpret the three-dimensional duality web in terms of the four-dimensional theories, but they're not actually strictly four-dimensional dualities. They're still three-dimensional dualities, and you have to You have to interpret them in the context of the bulk physics. A second reason to be optimistic is that typically these dualities take place at what's called the conformal fixed point of the theory. So everything has to do with massless fields in the 3D duality web. However, it turns it's an interesting observation that if you deform the theory away from criticality, so you do what's called gapping the theory, and you do that by adding a non-zero mass, then you can regularize the theory by adding this non-zero mass, dualize the regularized theory, and it actually works in that case, and then send the mass to zero. So in this sense, the mass is viewed as a regulator in the theory. And these are perfectly sensible things to do in this context. So there are indeed reasons to believe that perhaps there is a four-dimensional duality web. But before exploring the four-dimensional, before showing you that there is a four-dimensional duality web, I'm going to need to review the three-dimensional web of dualities to show you how precisely we do this dualization at the level of the partition function for these theories. But I see I'm now 10 minutes over my time, and so I'm going to end here today, having basically took today to motivate what we're studying and why we're studying it and somewhat how we're studying it. And then next week, I will review the three-dimensional duality web in some detail and show you how these bosonic theories are mapped to bosonic theories and fermionic theories and fermionic theories to fermionic theories. And then possibly in the week later, I'll complete this series by showing you how we lift this all to four dimensions, which is in some ways a generalization of the Maxwell duality that I'd started off this talk with. Okay, thank you. Any questions?
Jeff, I just made a comment to you privately, but I just say geometric algebra is a very interesting formalism which has dualities built into it. I wonder if you've looked at if geometric algebra might help with any of this.
I can't say that I've looked at geometric algebra. I have at some point. I think you referred me to this book by
Lazenby.
Yeah, by Lazenby. So I read it in that context. So one of the things that you might notice here is that if I go back to Maxwell's equations, one way of thinking of Maxwell's equations, so if I write Maxwell's equations in differential geometric language, then there are two sets of equations. One says that df equals zero, and the other one says that d star f equals zero. Okay, so df equals zero is the statement that divergences don't curl and curls don't diverge. Yep. Okay. So it's a statement that I can write f as dA, and so f is an exact form, and the exterior derivative operator is a nilpotent operator, so d squared is identically zero. So this is just a statement of geometry. Right, it's a fact that I write magnetic fields as the curl of a magnetic vector potential, and I write electric fields as the gradient of a scalar potential. Those are just geometric statements. The real dynamics of Maxwell's equations sit in this equation. Okay, d star f equals zero, and so then you'd ask, well, how this electric magnetic duality that I spoke about previously. How do I realize that in this language? Well, this is the statement that if I replace f with its Hodge dual, star f, then the vacuum Maxwell's equations are unchanged. Right? So electric magnetic duality is the same as Hodge duality in this context. And this is a very special thing to four dimensions because a two form is dual to a two form in four dimensions.
Correct. And that's one of the dualities in geometric algebra.
Correct. And so my statement here is that, you know, there's the deep statement. The statement here is that there's this thing in differential geometry called the Hodge duality, which maps a two form to a two form in four dimensions, right? In three dimensions, something completely different happens. In two dimensions, something completely different happens. But four dimensions is special in this regard that that in four-dimensional space, a two-form gets mapped to a four minus two equals two-form. And so in this sense, electric magnetic duality is built in to the geometric language to this geometric formulation of Maxwell's equations. And it turns out that actually, all of the stuff about electric magnetic duality and the geometric Langlands conjecture and stuff is all really this intricate web that's built around differential geometry. Yeah. And I'm assuming that this is tied into geometric algebra in some way, but I have nothing intelligent to say about that.
Okay, I've got to go, but just one other comment is that the D2A is naught. I suspect that is the statement that the boundary of a boundary is zero, which is... Okay, the dual of that statement. Misner, Thorne, and Wheeler talk about this quite a lot. I don't know if you ever looked at Misner, Thorne, and Wheeler on this.
I have. So this is so d squared equals zero is the Poincaré dual of that statement, that the boundary of a boundary is zero.
Yeah. Okay, I must go, but it's fascinating stuff. Congratulations.
Great, thanks. Any other questions?